I don't know if you're anything like me, but I've got a memory like a sieve. And you know those moments where you get into a bit of bother and you know it's going to kick off. You reach into your pocket to get your amulet and you realise you left it in the bathroom this morning when you were brushing your teeth. Well, these guys have got the perfect solution. They insert the amulets into their bodies.
Freezing cold, really, really cold. At first I was really afraid to go into the water. It's scary. Went for it. After about a minute or two, you start to lose your feelings, you start to lose care. It's a nice feeling actually when you sit with that and you just think, okay, I'll tell you what, if you're going to sit here for 5 minutes, I'll sit here for 10. I know at the end of the day, if I pass out, they'll drag me out, won't they? Hopefully. Feeling fantastic. Freezing cold. We're going to go back now and get hammered on sake. So I quite like this. I might convert.
There's a difference between power that comes from sport and exercise and genuine power that comes from old traditional martial arts. And this guy's got it. He's got the old stuff. His thing is all about eyes first. Look at the opponent's eyes, number one. Number two, posture, yeah? Drop your breathing, lower your weight, centre yourself. And number three, kick the shite out of them. Obviously, you hit a tile, you get a cut, you hit a bit of wood, you know, it hurts. Use chi, a breathing exercise. Yeah, you just go through it like butter. Fuck! But you won't catch me in the pub doing this before I fight. Hang on a minute. Anything else? Anything else to break? I'm in the mood now.
I mean, if we wanted to break through ropes to break them up for a skip, we'd have to use a sledgehammer or something, basically. You see it in the movies and you think it's all special effects, but obviously it's not. He's obviously controlling some sort of power. It's very impressive.
We've all been in sticky situations, but if it gets tough, the big question is what can you do? For example, what if someone jumps out and demands your car keys?
Give us your keys!
My mugging masterclass shows you what to do. What do you do if you're being chased by someone who's clearly faster than you? These world champion athletes couldn't catch me, and I'll show you how.
You know everybody in there.
You can't catch me if you can't find me.
And how do you deal with the drunk in a bar? Bar Fight Survival Guide might just save your life. So what do you do with a road rager and a baseball bat?
Get him! Get him!
Believe it or not, there's some really simple techniques to get out of all of those situations. And over the next few days, I'm going to be taking 5 students and teaching them how to cope on the mean streets of Britain. The moves you're about to see performed are dangerous if attempted by amateurs, so remember, don't try this in your local. So what if you find yourself in a bar trying to have a quiet drink and someone's had one too many? Screaming orgasm, please, barman.
This whole incident is sparked off by a simple accidental elbow nudge.
Sorry, mate, didn't mean that. You try and pacify him, he's having none of it. So buy another drink.
First, I block to defend myself. I slip my hand behind his neck and drive him down hard onto my knee. It's at that point that I should probably try and make my escape. This final punch would be deemed too excessive. Before I know what's what, I'm jumped on by his mate, who gets in several blows. He pulls my head back for the final knockout. I regain composure, block the chop, pick him up and run him into a table, knocking him clean out. Suddenly, someone watching decides to have a pop, and I get bottled. It's not too painful, but this broken table leg would probably kill me. It'd be too dangerous to use the chair leg against him, so I take him down with a simple punch and a kick. Having recovered, the first guy's still after my blood. This ain't the movies, and when my spinning kick misses, I opt for a more simple attack and then make my escape.
Maybe he didn't need that extra drink after all.
What do you usually do on a Saturday morning? Watch the football, or play a game with your mates maybe, or if you're anything like me, sleep off the night before.
Here in Chamali, in the goddess Kali temple, they come down bright and early to appease their goddess by sacrificing animals.
That's the goddess Kali, cutting the heads off and squirting blood all over.
Kali is the Hindu mother goddess of creation, preservation and destruction. Oh, and she's got an insatiable appetite for blood.
As you can see, she likes heads.
A visit to the Kali temple is a family day out.
You can see the line of people that stretches back here. There is thousands of people here on a Saturday morning all bringing their sacrifices to the goddess of Kali.
Kali looks after those who look after her. She brings riches to the poor, revenge to the oppressed, and newborn joy to the childless.
I mean, this is the most, probably, the most legal extreme form of sacrifice now, because they can't sacrifice humans anymore. It's not allowed.
Just 200 years ago at the Kali Temple, Calcutta, a little boy was sacrificed every single day.
Now, we're not allowed inside the actual slaughter pit, which is just there, because we're not Hindus, but we can get a close look if you come over here.
There are still rumours of human sacrifice to Kali taking place, which have been perpetuated in Hollywood films like Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. But there's definitely no sign of it going on here.
Oh, another goat. A headless goat. Can we have a look at the head? They will eat the goats after they've slaughtered them, so they don't just waste it.
To you and me, this might all seem very macabre, but here it's part of daily life. In fact, we all make sacrifices in our own way.
So I give up things. You know, you give up your time, don't you? For money, you go to work. Or you give up your efforts, you go to the gym and you exercise and you train and you get something in return. And that's basically the essence of what sacrifice is all about. There are literally every Saturday morning hundreds of slaughters here. My teacher always used to say to me, I'd say, how do I become a better martial artist? He'd say, you get out exactly what you put in. It's that balance. Give something to get something. I don't know if I'd want to slaughter my pets, though.
I really don't know about these shoes. There's nothing worse than having wet feet. I reckon if the samurais had Gore-Tex, it'd still be around today. They put on the left shoe first because it's the old samurai manners to go from left to right. The same way with the jacket, the left goes under and the right goes on the outside. If you wear it the other way, it means you're going to die. Oh, this is the big one, isn't it? The body shell. Protect me from any stabs in the chest. Do you like the nipple tassels? As soon as you start wearing this stuff and acting the toss, I think we're going to start listening, aren't they? Big sword on your side. Bit of a reputation, being a bit handy with it as well. Nice little knuckle duster, isn't it, though? Well, that's the finished product, then. I feel like a man now. When you've got this thing on, you can really imagine those boys getting stuck in, you know? There's no mucking around with this stuff, is there? It's kill or be killed. All your normal, usual type attacks are protected. Cut, it'll slice down and out, yeah? Shins are out of the question. Knees are kind of out of the question. In fact, there's not anywhere here that's exposed. Sort of areas that they could attack here, if they can get there, but don't forget when the samurai's holding his sword, yeah, it's very difficult to get to that part, isn't it? The throat is obviously a good one. So that was a favourite with the ninjas, wasn't it? Get behind them, wrestle with them, get behind them and cut the throat, because the throat's exposed. Going out on the pool wearing this latest line. The Japanese birds love it. This is martial arts movie style, and believe it or not, you've actually got to be a really good fighter to look good and not kill the bloke. Wow. Yeah. Basically, they're very skilled, so you don't need to worry about their movements, which is a complete departure from martial arts as you usually understand it. So you don't need to worry about their moves. All you need to concentrate on is making your moves look good. You like your hat, huh?
Yeah.
Hey. It's getting better. So basically, when you're hitting the guy, you're actually trying to sort of avoid him and look as if you're hitting him. And when you hit him, bang, and you kick him, ooh, you know he's moving out of the way, so you've got to kick and turn very quickly. And all the moves have to be very dramatic and filled with power. He's got to keep concentrating now to keep his chi in his chest. If he doesn't, it's all right doing it with a bicycle, but now this bloke's going to do it with a motorbike, and they're heavy, you know, motorbikes are heavy. If he doesn't hold his concentration, this thing's going to puncture his lungs. Rather him than me.
Go!
Oh!
OK.
Good. Feel the weight of that. It's got to be a couple hundred kilos. Make sure.
Hey, this is.
Wow. I asked him, is there anywhere that you can't put chi? He says, no, you can put it anywhere, even in his eyes, his eyeballs. So I guess these skills would have developed originally because a lot of kung fu, they hit to the balls, they hit to the throat, and they hit to the eyes. So if you can strengthen up. Oh, you're joking. Look at that. He's actually putting them right on his eyeballs. Oh, come on, mate. He's in there laughing, eh? So he's going to bend these iron rods. That is on his eyeballs. It's unreal, isn't it? It's unreal.
几只？三只。哇！Wow.
I'm asking how many fingers.
几只？两只。哦，试一下。
Okay, look at this place, treasure house of bizarre secret weapons. Look at these things. This thing catch my eye. This spike here. So you've got a 6-foot pole there for fighting. Your natural reaction as a martial artist, if that was thrust at you, is to try and move out of the way and perhaps catch it. If you caught that thing, it'd just twist it. It'd tear your hand to pieces. Those things there, on the end. They're for catching swords and twisting them and breaking them off. And that thing on the end is just for pain and suffering. More for steel fans. These things look like fans, you see. You'd think it's a fan. It'd be worn by samurai to meetings where they had to leave their sword at reception. And actually, it's a very heavy club.
It's a kosh.
Blocking, striking, striking, and finishing off. And what he did when he struck the sword, yeah, although he struck the sword in real life, he'd hit to the hand, so you've got to drop the sword, yeah. Samurai would also use this thing if they didn't want to draw their sword. So if they didn't want to kill the person that offended them, they'd just give them a couple of licks with this thing, and that should do the job. It's got a weight to it. It's a bit like a chisel. It's basically a chisel. Got to get one of those. Take that home to the missus. She'll love that. Excuse me, mate. Sorry, mate.
Yes.
Would you mind belting me across the head with your snooker cue?
I've got no problem with that recently.
Yeah?
You
crack me in the head with it as hard as you can. Yeah? You know most people, if you were to pick something up at them, they stand back and they move out of the way, yeah? Essentially, that's your natural reaction, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because you're lifting up that cue to hit me, yeah? If I move back or lift up my arms, I know if you do it just slowly, very slowly, yeah? I know it's going to break my arms, possibly hit my head, and then the bloke can break dance on your head. So what we try and do is get close, so when they swing at you, just do it slow, yeah? I try and get in, because if I'm in, it ain't going to hurt me too much anyway, is it, this thing here?
No,
do you know what I mean? And if I can turn around with you, the other bloke's force should take him over that way, innit? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So they're swinging, you just add a little bit on, over they go, take it off them, and carry on with the game.
That's the one. I'm not someone you mess with, and I'd have took his head off. He was better than me at the day.
Now, we've all seen Cole walking before, haven't we? But, take a look at that, come here. Feel the heat from here. That's why there's nobody in this section here, because that is hot. How am I going to run across that? How am I going to run across that? Jesus. It's burning me from here. It's burning me from here, let alone getting on it. The reality of the situation is, if I go on that,
I'm coming off looking like overcooked bacon. Crispy bacon. That'll be me in about 10 minutes. I've got to move away from it, it's so bloody hot, let alone get on there with my bare feet.
It's now I discover they used 72 bags of charcoal to make this pyre. 72 being a lucky number at this festival. They flatten it a bit, but it's still deep and very hot. In fact, it's about 10 times hotter than any other firewalking pyre I've seen.
Looking at that now and realising the depth, I can see that's about a foot and a half high of burning hot, red hot coal. It's been melting the metal that they've been using to try and straighten it. Well, I need to make sure that I don't go full of my face, basically.
The local guys believe that to cross this raging inferno unharmed, they've got to get themselves possessed by a god of the temple first. But how am I going to manage?
I know I've got to do that, so it's no good me telling myself I'm going to get burned all the rest of it. I probably am. But what I've got to do now is give myself the confidence to get across there as quick as possible without falling over. Any positive thing I can grab onto in my mind, I'm using that now as fuel. Vince, I'm not.
I'm away in the half way,
The man in charge notices I'm not possessed like the others, and he worries I'm about to be fried alive.
This guy just took a double look at me and he was like, what are you doing here? You shouldn't be here, you're not one of the boys. That is red. Ready?
Fucking hell.
You can't keep them in there for too long because I don't know what hurts. More going on that hot coal and putting them in this bucket of ice. But flesh burns for 20 minutes after you've been in extreme temperatures.
It's in traction. I don't know whether to laugh or cry. I'm in so much pain.
Oh, jeez. It's all started swelling up here.
The news from the doctor isn't good.
Second degree burn.
Second degree burn.
Yes.
How serious is that?
Yeah.
Blisters?
Yeah.
So there will be blisters.
Artificial skin graft.
How about those painkillers? Can we have those painkillers now?
Okay.
Yeah, oh, it'd be good. Be a good call. Within a few minutes, I'm completely knocked out with a double dose of morphine.
Come in today. This is about 12 hours later after the burns. But still got a trick up my sleeve. And open the bandages. I heal very quickly.
Really small burn. Not serious. Okay.
But you're surprised?
Yeah.
No pain? No pain at all. Feels great. I think I can moonwalk.
I'll leave it up to you how I went from second degree burns to moonwalking within 12 hours, and all I'll say is power of the mind. These boys show me the god they claim possessed them, and they say he's the reason they didn't get burned. But either way you look at it, I reckon walking around without shoes on all day would certainly have toughened up their feet a fair bit, just like the lads who climb the ladder of razor blades.